الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد, I welcome you to this topic of ours entitled The Massacre of Karbala, a Historical Analysis. And this is a very long and drawn out topic. So before I begin, and I will begin immediately, I need to make three disclaimers. The first disclaimer: this topic is a very contentious one. It raises a lot of emotions. It is potentially possible to stoke the fans of hatred, the flames of anger between Sunnis and Shia. And therefore, I want to state for the record very clearly that I am completely and totally opposed to stirring any bigotry, any hatred against any group. No doubt, I am a Sunni and I'm proud of being a Sunni, and I disagree with Shia theology and their interpretation of history. Yet this disagreement that I have, and all of us really have, and they have with us, this disagreement should be kept civil. And it should never lead to violence or anger or hatred. In this world, Sunni and Shia should dialogue and debate, but we should never get violent with one another because of the differences in our belief. And the purpose of this lecture is just to educate, is just to talk about what we as Sunnis believe about Karbala and how we view the incident of Karbala. It's not meant to stoke anger or hatred against any group. Also, another disclaimer, the second disclaimer, obviously Karbala is a very detailed and a very important event in our history, and by its very nature, history is subjective. There's always interpretations, there's always motives being read in, and in this short lecture, and I have only 1.5 hours, there is no way that we can go into a detailed analysis, variations of history, what book X said compared to book Y, why does book X say this, why does book Y say this, what are the strengths and weaknesses of each interpretation. We have no time for any of that. And it is very easy to give 10 lectures just on Karbala. I'm only giving you one lecture, so by the very nature of this lecture, we have to condense, we have to summarize, and I am not going to be mentioning variations as I do in my Sira class. You're literally just going to have to trust me and my authority for today's lecture that I'm giving you one interpretation. But I just want to point out the interpretation that I will be giving is the standard interpretation of Sunni Islam. It is taken from the writings of Ibn Hajar, of Ibn Kathir, of the important historians of Sunni Islam, and by and large it is agreed upon. And the third and final disclaimer, that the other version, we have this version, there is another version that is popularized by the Shia, and most of this comes from one particular person. The details of that version comes from one person, and this person was a very early Muslim historian who was also Shia, and his name is Abu Mikhnaf Lut ibn Yahya, and he died 157 Hijrah. And Abu Mikhnaf Lut ibn Yahya was the first early historian to write a detailed booklet about the massacre of Karbala, and he called it Maqtalu Hussein. And this booklet, Maqtalu Hussein, became the standard version, full of lurid details, full of a lot of things that allegedly took place. And from our perspective, this author and his book are not authoritative. All of our scholars have said that this person is not somebody that can be trusted in narrations, because he theologically is inclined towards the other group, and therefore he has a version of events that we do not agree with, and we will not really be concentrating on that version of events. As I said, our version will be by and large Ibn Kathir and Ibn Hajar and the standard Sunni historians. Now, we begin our talk, and I want to begin by mentioning what is our perspective with the Ahlul Bayt, with the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah firmly believe that the Ahlul Bayt have a very high rank and are the most blessed of all families. We love them with a genuine love. We love them with a genuine love between the two extremes. On the one hand, we have those, and they did exist, and they still exist, who consider the Ahlul Bayt to be like any other family, or even worse than this, astaghfirullah, they curse them. And that has been a trend that has existed, and there are still some people like this. And on the other hand, we have the other trend of Islam, and this trend considers the Ahlul Bayt to be above and beyond other families in a supernatural manner. And they give them powers, and they give them privileges, and they give them attributes that we believe only belong to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe that the Ahlul Bayt are the most respected family in the whole world. if they are righteous. So the mu'mins and the Muslims amongst them have a double blessing. They are believers and they are Ahlul Bayt. And the companions amongst them have a triple blessing, such as Ali ibn Abi Talib and Fatima and others, that they are Ahlul Bayt and they are Sahaba and they are believers. And therefore, we love them with a love that is triple if they are characterized by all of these characteristics. And we firmly affirm the blessings mentioned regarding them in the Quran and in the Sunnah. And as for the Quran, Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. That Allah wants to purify you of any filth, O أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ. And Allah wants to cleanse you a good cleansing. This is in the Quran. And in the hadith, we firmly believe that the Prophet ﷺ called Fatima and Ali and Hassan and Hussein, and this is called the hadith of the cloak, hadith al-kisa. And this is in our sources and we believe in it. That he called Ali and Fatima and Hassan and Hussein and he put them under a cloak. And he said, O Allah, these are my Ahl Bayti, these are my family. So we affirm this and we say that they are the most blessed family. And we firmly believe and we implement what our Prophet ﷺ said, as narrated in Sahih Muslim, that he said to the Sahaba and those after them, أُذَكِّرُكُمُ اللَّهَ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِ, that I remind you by Allah and by the rights of Allah for the rights of my family. أُذَكِّرُكُمُ اللَّهَ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِ, أُذَكِّرُكُمُ اللَّهَ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِ. He repeated this 3 times. So we love them with a love that is above and beyond any other family love. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he said to Ali ibn Abi Talib, I swear by Allah, I would rather be kind and generous to the Ahlul Bayt than to my own family. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq said, I would rather be kind and generous to the Ahlul Bayt, and he's speaking to Ali, than to my own family. And Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, when he wrote down the dawaween, and the dawaween was a schedule of who will get how much money. It was a schedule of stipends. When he wrote down the dawaween, the number one category and the highest amounts were to the Ahlul Bayt. And the Ahlul Bayt got more than even he himself got as a salary. The Ahlul Bayt were the number one category. And this shows us that the love that Abu Bakr and Umar had for the Ahlul Bayt. And Umar loved the Ahlul Bayt so much that he actually wanted to establish kinship with them. And that is why he proposed to the daughter of Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he married Umm Kulthum bint Ali. There could be no animosity between Umar and Ali, Umar and Ali, when Umar is proposing and Ali is accepting the marriage of his own daughter to Umar. And so Umar married the daughter of Ali. And one of the reasons he gave, he said, I wanted to have some relationship with the Ahlul Bayt. So we are Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. We love the Ahlul Bayt with the genuine love. And this has been the position of all Sunni scholars of Islam. Ibn Taymiyyah says, min usuli Ahl Sunnah, of the fundamentals of Ahl Sunnah, is to love the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But we also say that if a person is not righteous, if a person is sinful, then it doesn't matter what his bloodline is. His sins are one thing and his bloodline is another. And a person's bloodline will never save him from the consequences of his own deeds. And we base this on what our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. Hadith is in Tirmidhi, that man abta bihi amaluhu lam yusri'hu nasabuhu. Whosever's deeds pulled him back, his blood will not push him forward. Whosever's deeds pulled him back, his blood will not push him forward. So we say that just because a person is of the descendants of Ahlul Bayt, it doesn't make him an angel. It is possible that some of the Ahlul Bayt will commit sins. And those sins they are responsible for. And historically this has been the case. And to this day, there are dynasties and there are lineages that claim to be Ahlul Bayt. And some of those claims are valid. And we see these people have sins and they have good deeds. Just because a person belongs to Ahlul Bayt does not make him an angel. He can be just like, and she can be like any Muslim with good and bad. When they're righteous, we love them with the double love. When they are other than that, then we say Allah Azza wa Jal will take charge of their affair. Also, there is a fundamental difference between the definition of Ahlul Bayt for us and for the 12er Shia. As for them, primarily the Ahlul Bayt really is the descendants of Fatima. That's really what they concentrate on, the descendants of Fatima, Hassan and Hussein. As for us, We say the Ahlul Bayt, no doubt, is Hassan and Hussein, and they are the gist of the Ahlul Bayt, the crux of the Ahlul Bayt, but the Ahlul Bayt is broader than them. We have many categories of Ahlul Bayt. And first and foremost, by the testimony of the Quran and the Sunnah, the wives of the Prophet ﷺ are inside the Ahlul Bayt. The very verses that talk about Ahlul Bayt in the Quran, that you Ahlul Bayt, the very context is about the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. Ya Nisa al-Nabi, Ya Nisa al-Nabi, Ya Nisa al-Nabi. And Allah says in the same surah, his wives are their mothers. So the wives are from the Ahlul Bayt. Fatima and Hassan and Ali and Hussein are the gist, the kernel, the main part of the Ahlul Bayt. And we also affirm this. But we also affirm Aqil, the cousin of, or the brother of Ali, and Ja'far, the brother of Ali, and their children are Ahlul Bayt. And we also affirm Abbas, the uncle of the Prophet, and his descendants are Ahlul Bayt. For us, all of these lines are Ahlul Bayt, and we are not allowed to give charity to any of the Ahlul Bayt out of respect to them. We do not give zakat to any of the descendants of Fatima and Ali and Ja'far and Aqil and Abbas. All of these descendants for us are Ahlul Bayt. And as for them, they do not really consider the descendants of Abbas to be Ahlul Bayt and others as well. There's a lot of rivalry between the Shi'atu Ali and the Ahl al-Abbas for historical reasons. For us, the Ahl al-Abbas are also Ahlul Bayt. Now, as for Hussein ibn Ali, and he is the subject of our talk today. Hussein ibn Ali was born in Sha'ban of the fourth year of the Hijrah. Less than 1 year after Hassan was born. Hassan was born in Ramadan of the third year. And barely had Fatima become cleansed of the delivery when she became pregnant again with Hussein. So Hassan and Hussein are less than a year apart. And there are many ahadith that our Prophet ﷺ praised Hassan and Hussein. And with regards to Hassan and Hussein, the Prophet ﷺ said, Hassan and Hussein are the leaders of the young men of paradise. Sayyida Shababi Ahlil Jannah. And once he hugged the both of them and he said, Huma rayhanatayya min ad-dunya. Hassan and Hussein are my two sweet flowers, fragrances of this world. Rayhanatayya, they bring me comfort, they're sweet, they're blessed. These are my two blessings in this world. And we affirm for them all that the Prophet ﷺ affirmed for them. Hussein was born in Medina, and he lived in Medina until Ali became Khalifa. And when Ali became Khalifa, he moved to Kufa. So Hussein moved to Kufa with him. And Hussein witnessed the two battles of Jamal and Siffin along with his old brother Hassan, and then Ali was assassinated, as you know, by the Khawarij. When Ali was assassinated, Hassan was given the oath of allegiance by the people of Kufa, and Muawiyah was given the oath of allegiance by the people of Syria. For the first time in the Muslim world, there were two Khalifas, Hassan on the one side and Ali and Muawiyah on the other. And Muawiyah and Hassan were about to go to war again, but Hassan resigned. Hassan, after 6 months, he resigned. And he did not want any further bloodshed. And so the Ahl al-Bayt returned to Medina after Hassan's resignation. And Hussein moved to Medina and he lived there until the death of Muawiyah in 60 AH, in 60 after the Hijrah, and Yazid coming to power, after which Hussein left Medina. So Medina, Kufa, Medina, and then he left Medina. And we'll talk about his leaving once we get to Yazid and how he came to power. There is no doubt that Hussein was greatly respected in his lifetime by all of the companions. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As was once sitting in the shadow of the Kaaba, and he saw Hussein coming, and he said, this man is the most beloved man on earth to the inhabitants of the heavens. There's nobody more beloved to those up there than this man. And this is coming from Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. Now, let's talk a little bit about Yazid and the coming of power to Yazid before we get to now the problems between the two. We are all aware, vaguely, even though many of us have not studied this in detail, that towards the end of the time of the Khulafa al-Rashidun, civil war broke out between the Sahaba. And more Muslims lost their lives in this civil war in Jamal and Siffin than all of the Muslims who had participated in Ghazu against the Kuffar. More Muslims lost their lives in these two wars than all of the Muslims before this time fighting against the Sassanids and the Farisiyun and the Rum. All of those Muslims were less than the Muslims who died in Jamal and Siffin. It was a very traumatic civil war, and the quantity of Muslims that died was just horrendous. Now, as we said, when Hassan came to power in 41 Hijra, and Muawiyah came to power the same year, the two of them almost went to a third civil war, a third battle. There was Jamal, there was Siffin, there was going to be a third battle, bigger and more horrendous than the previous two. When, after much contemplation, Hassan said, no, no more blood is going to be spilled. Khalas, you wanted that bad, Muawiyah, take it. I will give up. And we as Ahl Sunnah believe that Hassan was more entitled to be the Khalifa than Muawiyah. And Hassan was more righteous than Muawiyah. But Hassan was also, because of his righteousness, he did not want to spill any blood. And so he voluntarily gave up, and the Kufiyun, the people of Iraq, had a difficult time accepting his own surrender, because he's their leader. But he managed to quell them down, he managed to calm them down, and with a great deal of difficulty, the people of Iraq grudgingly decided to khalas, throw their towel in with the rest of the ummah, and Hassan retired peacefully to where? To Medina. He retired to Medina. And Hussein, it is said, was not happy with his brother's decision. And he expressed this, but Hassan calmed him down and said, this is better for the ummah. And out of respect for his older brother, Hussein did not do anything while his brother was alive. And he also lived a quiet life, and Hassan died in 50 AH. 50 after the hijrah, Hassan passes away in Medina. Now, after the death of Hassan, Yazid ibn Muawiyah was nominated by his own father to become the successor. And who is Yazid and who is Muawiyah? Yazid ibn Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan ibn Sakhr ibn Harb ibn Umayyah. Right? The Banu Umayyah. And the Banu Umayyah and the Banu Hashim were the most elite of the Quraysh. And even though they were cousins, there was also, as always the case between cousins and brothers, some type of rivalry between the two. And this is known throughout the seerah. And that is why when the Prophet ﷺ conquered Mecca, he made the house of Abu Sufyan one of the most noble houses, to give the honor to the Banu Umayyah, to give them the izzah that they wanted. And Abu Sufyan is, of course, Yazid's grandfather, right? Abu Sufyan is the leader. The Badr took place because of Abu Sufyan's caravan. Uhud, he was the leader, Abu Sufyan, right? So Abu Sufyan's grandson is Yazid. Abu Sufyan's son is Muawiyah. Muawiyah's son is Yazid. Yazid, by unanimous consensus of all the scholars of Islam, is not a Sahabi. He's not a companion. He was born in the year 26 Hijrah. 26 after the Hijrah. So more than 15 years after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the first thing that we hear about him as a young man was that his father put him in charge of attacking the famous Roman city of Constantinople, Qisṭintiniyya, which is now called Istanbul, the city of Constantinople. His father Muawiyah put Yazid as a young man in his 20s in charge of the army that will attack Constantinople in the heart of the Roman Empire. And it was in this battle that Abu Ayyub al-Ansari passed away. And that is why to this day, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, his grave is in one of the suburbs of Istanbul. To this day, Abu Ayyub al-Ansari, his grave is in the suburb of Istanbul. Because it is said that when Abu Ayyub was about to die, he told Yazid that charge in as far as you can go, and wherever you get, just bury me there as close to the walls of Constantinople as you can. And that's exactly what Yazid did, that he charged in as far as he could go, and he then buried Abu Ayyub al-Ansari over there. Now, not ironically, but very interesting, Hussein actually participated as well in this ghazu. So Yazid and Hussein are on the same side fighting against the Romans, and yet history would have a different turn 30, 40 years later. Now, there's also a hadith, by the way, that we need to be aware of about this incident, and it is reported in Bukhari. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the first army from my ummah to attack the city of the Caesar shall be forgiven. أول جيش يغزو مدينة قيصر مغفور لهم. The first army that shall attack the city of Caesar, which is Constantinople, shall be forgiven. And this is really the one blessing that we have to give to Yazid, that he was the leader of this army, and no doubt, along with his other issues that we will talk about, and we are fair, we look at the good and the bad, the one positive that he has, and even Imam al-Dhahabi, who is overall very negative of Yazid, he says, with all of his evil, he got this one blessing. And that is the blessing of participating in the army of attacking Constantinople. Now obviously it was not successful and they came back, but it was the first attack on Constantinople. Now Muawiyah, after the death of Hassan, decided to nominate Yazid to be the Khalifa after him. And this issue has a lot of talk, pros and cons, which is beyond the scope of this class. And the bottom line that I will just say quite categorically, and there's no question about this, we firmly believe that there were far more people qualified to be the Khalifa than Yazid, that Ibn Umar was alive, Ibn Zubayr was alive, Hussein was alive, all of these people were alive. And it is something that we firmly believe that these people were more qualified and righteous. And yet, we also believe that it is allowed for a person of lesser stature to be the Khalifa in the presence of those who are of higher stature. This is called Imamatul Mafdul. A person who's of lesser stature is allowed to be the Khalifa. It's not the best, it's not ideal, it's allowed over those who are better than him. And we do not have to agree with Muawiyah's decision. This is a very fundamental point of Sunni theology. We respect the Sahaba in their Islam, but we do not have to agree with every political decision they made. We have to be very clear about this, right? We have every right to say, look, that wasn't the best decision, or that was the best decision. But what we cannot do is to cast aspersions on the niyyah and the character of Muawiyah radiallahu ta'ala. He is a sahabi. End of story. He did what he did out of some concern for the ummah. Whether he's right and wrong, we have the right to discuss. But we cannot doubt his niyyah, that deep down inside, he wanted some benefit for the ummah. And of what the benefits he wanted, which are pretty obvious, he has witnessed the worst civil wars that were caused because of politics. He wants to close this chapter. And so he says, khalas, let there be no more fighting. My son shall be the Khalifa after me. And he reasoned to himself, if Hassan can become the Khalifa after Ali, and Hassan and Ali are father, son and father, well then, why can't I? And that's his reasoning, but that's, we don't have to agree with it, but we must give him the benefit of the doubt. This is what our religion requires of us, that the Sahaba, by and large, we must consider them to be people who loved Islam and loved the Prophet and are not traitors, but we do not have to agree with their political decisions. The goal was unity, the goal was avoiding bloodshed, and Muawiyah felt, if I nominate my son, nobody can then go to civil war. And so in the lifetime of Yazid, while he's alive, Muawiyah is alive, Yazid's alive, Muawiyah announces, every one of you must agree that after I die, my son Yazid shall become the Khalifa after me. By and large, the bulk of the Muslim world agreed, but Mecca and Medina, the provinces of Mecca and Medina, refused. And Muawiyah let it linger. He didn't really force it too much on them. He just said, inshallah, he probably felt that when I die, they will have to follow along. And in Mecca, there was Abdullah ibn Zubayr, the son of Zubayr ibn al-Awwam. And in Medina, there was the Ahlul Bayt, Hussein and the other Ahlul Bayt. And they both felt that they are more qualified to be the Khalifa than Yazid. But in the lifetime of Muawiyah, they didn't do anything political. They just let it be. Muawiyah died in Rajab of 60 AH. So we're going in chronological order here. Rajab of 60, he died. And there were three people that the Ummah was looking at to see what are they going to do. There were three people who had enough clout, enough respect, enough political capability that if they caused a hue and cry, the Umayyads are in trouble. Who are these three people? Number one on the list, and most of us ignore him because he was apolitical, Abdullah ibn Umar, the son of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Abdullah ibn Umar was the senior most Sahabi that was alive at this time. He is the senior most, the most respected Sahabi. Remember, Hussein, his respect primarily is lineage. But he was barely 6-7 years old when the Prophet passed away. Remember, right? His respect is his blood, his lineage, and that is a high respect. But Ibn Umar participated in Ghazawat. Ibn Umar participated in Uhud and all the battles afterwards. Ibn Umar is a faqih, he's a scholar, and we're not comparing, no doubt, but each has his the points. And Ibn Umar was senior to Hussein in terms of experience, age, and basically participating in ghazawat, right? And of course, Hussein is senior in terms of blood. Nobody can deny that. So Ibn Umar was the main person that the Ummah was looking at, and Ibn Umar decided to be apolitical. And that is why Ibn Taymiyyah, for example, praises Ibn Umar as having the most wisdom, that not having any bloodshed. That Ibn Umar said, let me not get involved, let the Ummah has suffered enough. And he gave his bay'ah to Yazid, but he never took part in politics. And he said to his children that, look, if there's good in Yazid, then alhamdulillah good. If there's bad, then we will be patient at his evil and we'll let Allah judge him. He was not pro-Yazid, but he didn't make a stand anti-Yazid. He just lived his life with ibadah and ilm and tahajjud, and he didn't get involved in politics. The second person was Abdullah ibn Zubayr. And again, Abdullah ibn Zubayr is senior to Hussein in age. Only in age, obviously, otherwise, he is senior to Hussein in age. And he also has done much. And his father is a Sahabi, his mother is a Sahabi, his grandfather, his whole family is a family of prestige, Abdullah ibn Zubayr. And he was also a political person from a young age. And Abdullah ibn Zubayr decided to revolt. And he revolted in Mecca. And the third person on this list, which is the one that we're going to discuss, is Hussein ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib. So let's talk about Hussein now. What happened? Muawiyah dies. And the governor of Medina knows the tension between Hussein and the Umayyads. So the governor of Medina calls Yazid to his residence, his house. And, sorry, not Yazid, Hussein. The governor of Medina calls Hussein to his house. And he asks him to give the oath of allegiance in public tomorrow in the masjid. Let's quell any problems, give me the oath of allegiance. And he kept on insisting. But Hussein refused. And Hussein, when he saw the pressure coming, he said, okay, give me some time, let me think, let me see what I can do. And the governor was a soft man. We know who he is and everything. He's a soft-spoken man. He was not a very harsh person. And so he let it go. Hussein immediately left to his house and informed his family to pack. And they were leaving in 2 hours, literally. Like, they're just going to leave the whole city. And the same night, Hussein, along with the immediate family, left for Mecca in the middle of the night. Hussein left for Mecca in the middle of the night. And he made his way to Mecca. Why did he go to Mecca? Because Mecca was relatively less under the control of the Umayyads. There was still a little bit more tension. The sympathizers of Abdullah ibn Zubayr as well were over there. And therefore, he wanted to go to Mecca in order to flee the stronghold of Medina. So within the same night, he fled to Mecca. News became public that Hussein had fled. And he had not given the oath of allegiance to Yazid, the governor, which is Yazid, meaning, you know, the governor on behalf of Yazid. And when this spread to Iraq, the people of Iraq, and in particular the people of Kufa, they rejoiced because they were waiting for rebellion. The people of Kufa were never happy with the Umayyads. And when they heard this, it was now Ramadan of 60 Hijrah. So now it's Ramadan. So the message comes to them that Hussein has refused the allegiance. Their hopes soar. And they start sending letters and delegations to Hussein in Mecca, telling him that the time is now ripe. We will be behind you. Come and we will fight against the forces of the Umayyads. And it is said in our books that more than 60 messages came to him from the people of Kufa. On a daily basis, people kept on sending. Every tribe, the tribe of Kindah and the tribe of all of the major tribes of the region of Kufa, they sent their representatives and they're telling him that, come over, we need you to lead us against the rebellion, against the Umayyads. And they sent many promises and threats as well. The threats being that, look, we're not even going to pray Jumu'ah until you come. What is the issue of praying Jumu'ah? Praying Jumu'ah was also a political act in that the Khalifa or the governor led Jumu'ah prayer. Right. So in those days, the governor was the one who led Jumu'ah prayer. And therefore, by not praying Jumu'ah, you are sending the message, we don't consider you to be legitimate. We're not going to pray behind you. So they sent a message to Hussein, we're not even praying Jumu'ah until you come. And that's the message, like, you had better come, we are desperate for your attention. And lists upon lists of noblemen signed their names that come and we will be with you fighting against the Umayyads. Now, remember the city of Kufa. What is Kufa? Kufa was a very unique and peculiar place. And in the year 37 It was the year that Ali shifted his caliphate to Kufa, and ever since that time, Kufa became the place of sympathy for the Ahlul Bayt. And it was in Kufa that the political movement known as Shi'ism began. Let me repeat. It was in Kufa that the political movement known as Shi'atu Ali began. In the beginning, it was a political movement. No theology, no aqidah, no cursing of the sun, nothing like this. It was just politics. We think Ahlul Bayt should be the Khalifa. Right, and this they call themselves Shi'atu Ali. Ali himself had a lot of trouble with his own Shi'a, and there are many recorded conversations and many expressions of frustration from Ali himself that you're not doing what you can. There's a lot of you're not listening to me as well as you should, and there's a lot of akhbar about Ali's own tensions with the people of Kufa. Now, as we had said, when Hassan resigned, the people of Kufa were not happy and they wanted rebellion, but Hassan calmed them down. And they were still wanting a rebellion. Hassan passes away, Hussein now takes charge. So they say to Hussein, your brother didn't do it, you come and do it. Come and we will fight you. So a fight with you, behind you, against the Umayyads. Now, Hussein, after getting all of these rasail, all of these letters, he decided to send his cousin to check out, is it really worth it for me to go? Are we sure that we're able to go? And he sent his cousin, Muslim ibn Aqil ibn Abi Talib. So Aqil is his older brother, older uncle. And Aqil is, of course, the brother of Ja'far and Ali, right? Ja'far Ali Aqil. Aqil is his brother, the brother of Ja'far and Ali. So the son of Aqil, his name is Muslim. So Muslim ibn Aqil is the first cousin of Hussein. Clear? So he sends one of the Ahlul Bayt, he is an Ahlul Bayt, and he says to him, check out. Is Kufa ready or not? Are they really serious about this or not? So Muslim ibn Aqil left with a small group, one or two people, that's it, just to find, scouting mission, right? Find out, is it worthwhile or not? And so Muslim arrives in Kufa in the month of Dhul Qa'dah, 60 AH. Look at how time is coming up now. We know Muharram 61 is all going to come to an end. Look now, we're already in Dhul Qa'dah, right? 2 months away from the massacre. We can see what's building up here. So he arrives in Kufa in the month of Dhul Qa'dah, and the people rejoice like they have never rejoiced before. And thousands upon thousands of people. At-Tabari says more than 12,000 people in the course of the next 2 weeks gave the oath of allegiance directly to Muslim. And when you give the oath of allegiance, this basically means, khalas, we are with you. End of story. No matter what happens, you are our leader. They gave the oath of allegiance to Muslim on behalf of Hussein, basically, that we're on the side of Hussein. And these 12,000 people, they represented the bulk of Kufa. Over 30,000, 40,000, because each one is representing a mini tribe. So every person who shakes the hand, there's 10 people, 15 people behind him. You get the point here, right? This is how they would do the bay'ah, that the leader or the elder would come and give the bay'ah. So the bulk of Kufa, 30,000 to 40,000 people, have now claimed that we are with Hussein. Muslim ibn Aqil is overjoyed. He's never seen this enthusiasm and support. And so he writes back a letter that you can sense his excitement. And he writes to Hussein that all of the people of Kufa are behind you. So as soon as you get this letter, do not delay, come immediately. He's excited. He's seen all of this. The people are just buzzing with excitement. So he says, okay, we are going. As soon as you get this letter, come forth, do not delay, and make your way to Kufa. Now, we're going to talk about the letter in a while. Let's finish up the story of Muslim. What happens to Muslim? Okay. So he sends this letter sometime in Dhul Qa'dah, the end of Dhul Qa'dah of 60 AH. Now, rumors of all of this, you cannot hide this from the people. Eventually, it reaches Yazid in Damascus. Remember, Yazid is in Damascus. Hussein is in Medina. And his supporters are in Medina and Mecca. Hussein is in Mecca right now, sorry. And his supporters are in Kufa, right? So remember the basic geography here. Now, rumors of this beginnings of an uprising eventually reach the ears of Yazid. And so, Yazid, the first thing that he does, he sends in the most vicious politician he knows. Get rid of the mediocre or the average guys. I want the shrewdest, the most vicious, the one who's going to solve it. And that was a person who's infamous in early Islam, and his name is Ubaydillah ibn Ziyad ibn Abihi. He's known as Ibn Ziyad. He's known as Ibn Ziyad. And Ibn Ziyad was really a Machiavellian politician. He got the job done regardless of the costs. He was loyal to the Umayyads completely at this time. And his only goal in life really was to rise in the ranks. He just wanted to do whatever was the job and basically rise in the ranks of the era of politics. And nobody really has any respect for Ibn Ziyad amongst the historians in terms of his morals, in terms of his political abilities. No doubt he was shrewd. That's why he was put in. So the first thing Yazid does, he gets rid of the governor of Kufa, who was actually, again, a gentle, nice person by and large, gets rid of him, says, you get out of here. And he sends Ibn Ziyad with an entourage, a grand total of 17 people. That's it. Ibn Ziyad doesn't need an army right now. He needs brains. He sends Ibn Ziyad with a grand total of 17 people. So Ibn Ziyad was well known, as we said, to be vicious. He was also rash and hot-tempered. And he was also very young. He's going to become the governor of Kufa. And do you know how old he was? 28 years old. And young men, generally speaking, are very rash. Young men don't act wisely, right? Young men are quick in their temper and their anger. And at this young age, Yazid is putting him in charge of the situation. And there is no doubt this was one of the most dangerous decisions that really led to immediately to Karbala. And that is putting this young, tempestuous, basically overzealous person in charge of the whole situation. So Ibn Ziyad enters Kufa in the month of Dhul-Qa'dah, 60 AH. And he tells the governor, basically, here's the letter of your resignation. You get out. I'm in charge now. Right? I'm going to deal with this. And it is said he entered Kufa after Fajr prayer, and he entered Kufa with the turban around his face, as they would typically do. And when he entered in the middle of the, basically not middle of the night, but early morning, and he had an entourage, the people thought he might be Hussein. So the people began chanting and praising, As-salamu alayka ya ibn Rasulillah, marhaban, you know, welcome, O son of the Messenger of Allah, we welcome you, and you have come to the noble place, and. So Ibn Ziyad understood that these rumors are true, that there is a plot, that things are happening here, they're waiting for Hussein to come, until finally one of the entourage, and he's quiet, you can see his shrewdness, he's trying, one of his entourage gets angry and says, shut up, be quiet, this isn't Hussein, this is your governor, Abdurrahman ibn Ziyad. And that's when people realized something is going on here, that the plot has been exposed. So Ibn Ziyad takes his residence in the fortress that was the governor's office, and he figures out, what am I going to do now? The first call to order, get to Muslim ibn Aqil. Who's Muslim ibn Aqil? The scout. Get to Muslim ibn Aqil and find out what's really happening. But how can he figure out where is Muslim ibn Aqil in this large city? How is he going to get to him? Notice his shrewdness. He takes one of his 17 men, anonymous, that was not known to the people, and he dresses him like a traveler, and he gives him a sack of gold coins, lots of money, and he gives him the plot. You shall pretend that you are Ahl al-Shia from Sham. You are Shia to Ali coming from Syria. And you make yourself known to the Shia until you say, I have to hand this money to the one in charge. This is an amana. I have a lot of money from the Shia of Sham. And until I get to the person in charge, I'm not going to give this money to him. So this spy, and this is a spy now, this spy spent the next few days basically getting into the houses of the people that were Shia, Shia to Ali. And when we say Shia, remember right now this is a political movement. Right now it's not a theology. Right now this is like Democrats and Republicans. Like you have people with a lot of anger and blood between Democrats and Republicans. Like not just, you know, two tame political parties here. And he makes his way slowly but surely to the house of the host of Muslim ibn Aqil. The host of Muslim. Who's hosting him? Lo and behold, one of the noblemen of Kufa who pretended to be on the Umayyad side was secretly a Shi'i. And this nobleman was known to the governor. You see, he's playing a game here now. One of the rich and elite pretends to be pro-Umayyad. In reality, he is pro-Hussein. And his name was His name was Hani ibn Urwa. Hani ibn Urwa. So Hani ibn Urwa was one of the noblemen, the leaders. He was like consider him to be, in our days, it would be like a senator or a congressman of the city. Like, he's known to everybody, and publicly he's pro-Umayyad. And he's visiting the governor's mansion every few days, right? Sipping tea with him. But in reality, he is pro-Shi'i. He's pro-Hussein. So lo and behold, this spy uncovers that Hani ibn Urwa is the main person organizing it. And Hani insists, you have to hand it to me. I'm not going to let you see Muslim ibn Aqil. Hand it to me. So he hands him the money, because now he's figured out this is the head, right? Soon as he hands him the money, he then basically slinks away, disappears, goes and tells Ibn Ziyad. The culprit is Hani ibn Urwa. He's the brains. And so Ibn Ziyad calls Hani to his residence. And after the civil duties are over, Ibn Ziyad tells him, you are the one who is housing Muslim ibn Aqil. Hand me over Muslim and I might forgive you. He denies, I don't know what you're talking about. Then he calls the spy out. And so Hani sees this plot has been exposed. The spy comes out and he goes, I'm the one who gave you the money, right? You're gonna now deny it to my face. So he realizes the plot has been exposed, and Ibn Ziyad takes his spear and causes him to bleed. He doesn't kill him on the spot, and he beats him up, because he's, in his eyes, he's a traitor. That we thought you were a respected person, and it turns out that you're backstabbing us. When the news that Hani is being beaten and he's being tortured spreads in the city, the tribesmen of Hani come to the governor's residence and they demand, you have to hand over our leader or else we will rebel. And Ibn Ziyad negotiates with them and he says, no, I have no intention to harm him. I'm just finding out where is Muslim ibn Aqil, and we're not going to do anything to him. Don't worry. So he calms them down and the tribesmen go back. In the meantime, of course, Muslim ibn Aqil realizes the plot's exposed. The plot's exposed. Realizing that khalas, there's no going back, he sends the secret message to his followers. There's a secret code that had been put into place, because again, realize the, and one of the reasons why later on Shia believed in this thing called taqiyya and hiding and whatnot, they really did go through political repression. They went through a lot of difficult times, so they had to invent a doctrine of hiding, of kitman, of keeping things secret. So he had a secret code, and that code was Ya Mansur Amit. Ya Mansur Amit was the code that we're going to attack. Come to arms and come prepared for battle. This was the secret code. So when he realizes that Hani has been imprisoned in the house of the governor, Ibn Ziyad, he sends forth the cry. Now remember, 12,000 had given him bay'ah by their hand. 40,000 of the city was technically behind him. Well, when the cry comes out, a semi-respectable 4,000 come forth. Out of the 12,000 that actually gave the bay'ah, 4,000 come armed to the hilt, ready for battle. And that's still okay, 4,000 against a small entourage of Ibn Ziyad, you might actually get somewhere. So these 4,000 come forth and they agree they're going to march to the fortress, the battle. They're going to free Hani and they're going to kill Ibn Ziyad. Now, Muslim ibn Aqil comes with his entourage of 4,000 and they camp outside the gate of the fortress. Ibn Ziyad, the shrewd politician that he is, he assesses who is out there, which tribes are out there. And from every one of the tribes that he sees, he finds a sympathizer in his own group and he negotiates a deal with them to cut off one tribe after another, right? You realize the Arabs at that time were tribes and every tribe is going to follow its leader. And so what he does is he works out with every single tribe, what do they need that they're going to not support Hussein and the Shi'at or the uprising against him. And slowly but and so much so, Al-Tabari and others, they mention, he even used mothers and fathers against their children. That he sent the mothers in to say that, come home now, can't you see there are so many people, don't worry about it, I don't want to lose you. It's emotional blackmail. And the fathers also said to their sons that, what are you going to do when the Syrians arrive with their troops? Are you going to die in battle? For what cause? Come home now. So he used whatever means that he can, and one by one, and in front of his very eyes, Muslim ibn Aqil's eyes, people began deserting the army until within that day, beginning in the morning at 4,000, by the time Asr comes along, less than 70 men are left. From 4,000, and again, remember, they are leaving in droves because Muslim ibn 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 Ziyad is negotiating with every tribe. And he's sending them bribes and he's doing whatever he can. You stop and I'll give you this. You remove your men and I'll give you that. And with a little bit of bribes, whew, they all dispersed. And by the time Muslim ibn Aqil prays Maghrib, barely 30 people prayed Salah behind him. And when he turned around and darkness has fallen from 30, it is now 10. And he is obviously fuming and angry and he is remonstrating with them, how could you have done this and that? Now what are we going to do? 10 people outside the gate, right? And he decides to basically regroup and spend the night in the quarters of the Kinda. The Kinda was one of the main supporters of Shi'atu Ali, the tribe of Kinda. And in those days, the city was divided into different tribes, like each tribe living in its own area. So he left the fortress and he walked his way back to Kinda with these 10 people. And subhanAllah, under the cover of night, and as he's walking in the alleyways, every one of these 10 slinks away until he literally finds himself alone, discarded, without even a shelter over his head, without even money or food or drink. Like literally to the last man, they abandoned the cousin of Hussein, and that is Muslim ibn Aqil, the grandson of Abu Talib. Muslim ibn Aqil ibn Abi Talib. This is the grandson of Abu Talib. They abandoned him down to a last man. How long did it take them? 12 hours. What would it require? Just money and bribes. That's all was required. And they all disappeared. And Muslim ibn Aqil is literally left penniless in a city that had promised 40,000 men. He doesn't even have food and water. And after a while, in the middle of the night, tired, hungry, thirsty, he is forced to go to an anonymous door, put his tawakkul in Allah, he knocks on the door. And an old lady of Kinda opens up and he says, I am a beggar wanting some food and water. SubhanAllah, this is the cousin of Hussein. I need some food and water. He's hungry. What is he going to do? And so the lady gives him whatever, some water and whatnot. And then he remains standing. She says, shoo, get away. I gave you what you wanted. But clearly something, you can tell this isn't just a beggar. And he decides to risk it. And he tells her, and it's an old lady. He tells her, I am Muslim ibn Aqil. Can you help me? Begging from an old lady because there's nothing else he can do. The lady has pity on him. And she says, come, I will protect you. So he goes into her house, and the next morning, her son comes from work to visit his mother, and there's a man in the house, so she has to explain. And she says, my son, please, I beg you, do not expose this man. He is Muslim ibn Aqil. But the son is greedy for money as well. And the son, within a day or two, he makes an excuse, he has to go to the masjid because he doesn't want to tell his mother that, you know, he's going. So he pretends to go to the masjid. He actually does go to the masjid. In the masjid, he sees the lieutenant of Ibn Ziyad and he tells the lieutenant that I have Muslim ibn Aqil in my house, send the troops. And so the next thing Ibn Aqil knows, his whole house is surrounded by troops. He tries to fight whatever he can, but obviously one man against a convoy, and also they threaten to burn the house down, and he doesn't want to cause harm to the old lady. And so he exits and he surrenders, and one of the people who is famous, but again these names have to just be glossed on, his name is Abdurrahman ibn Muhammad ibn al-Ash'ath, a very famous Ibn al-Ash'ath, well known to the historians. He was the leader of this entourage to arrest him. He promises him, I won't harm you, even though he was to break the promise. And so he surrenders. Ibn Aqil surrenders, and on his way to the governor's house, Ibn al-Ash'ath, he has a lot of pros and cons, and he has, again, historians have a lot to talk about him, but he did have some soft spot in the end of the day, and Ibn Aqil made Ibn al-Ash'ath promise one thing, just one thing, whatever you do with me, just one thing, get the message to Hussein that Ibn Aqil has sent you, that he has been taken prisoner, and for all he knows he might be killed, and the message is, get back to Mecca, go away, the people of Kufa will betray you, leave, flee for your lives. This is the message, right? And Ibn al-Ash'ath promised, okay, whatever happens, I will get this message to him, right? Don't worry then, that you have from me. And in fact, as we will see, he did do that. So Ibn Aqil says to Ibn al-Ash'ath, go tell Hussein, he's on his way, I sent him a letter, he must be on his way now. Go tell him that the Kufans have lied, they've betrayed me, and flee back to Mecca and Medina, do not step foot in Kufa. So, later on in that day, after he goes to the governor, and the governor also beats him up and is harsh and rude to him. And that day was the day of Arafah, the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah in the 60th year of the Hijrah. So we have 1 year left, or sorry, 1 month left before the massacre. On the 9th of Dhul-Hijjah, on the holiest day of the year, Mustab ibn Aqil, the grandson of Abu Talib, the son of the cousin of the Prophet ﷺ, the first cousin of Hussein, he is taken to the highest ramparts on the fortress, and in front of the whole city, he is thrown to his death to be killed in a humiliating manner. And the last words that he said before istighfar and tahleel and shahada, the last word that he said, O Allah, you be the judge between us and our own Shia, our own people. They deceived us and they deserted us. He said, that's the last thing he said before the kalima and before the shahada. You be the judge of Allah. They promised, they promised, they promised. And now here I am, not a single man to defend me. And of course, Hussein is on his way. And he has just now, Muslim ibn Aqil has been killed. Hussein has no way of knowing this now. Right? The only letter he got was, now remember, this is obviously before the age of telephones, internet, media. It will take at least 2.5 weeks from Kufa to Mecca, at least 2.5 weeks to get a message there, right? And therefore, Hussein gets the message, come immediately. Khalas, he packed his bags, as we'll talk about, he left, right? He has no idea what's happening in Kufa. The people have been betrayed. His cousin has been killed. The host that hosted him as well was not just killed, but crucified in the city center. And a number of other key players were killed and their bodies put in the city center for everybody to see. And the message is being given that this is what's going to happen if you turn against the Umayyad dynasty. Now remember, Ibn Ziyad had entered Kufa with only 17 men. And the infrastructure basically agreed to follow Ibn Ziyad. He didn't have the police entering. He didn't have the army right now. He didn't have any group. This was an instantaneous message that Yazid sends Ibn Ziyad with a small entourage. It was just the fear of what might happen if they disobey Ibn Ziyad that caused, and of course bribery, that caused all of the Kufans to basically disappear when they were most needed. And this was but a sign of what is about to happen. The killing of Ibn Aqil and the betrayal of Ibn Aqil was just one sign of what's going to happen. Now, all of this took place in Kufa. Let's now go to Medina. What's happening in Medina? Ibn Aqil was killed either 9th or 10th of Dhul-Hijjah. And Muslim Ibn Aqil, of course, had sent the letter to Hussein. Hussein has already gotten the letter weeks ago, right before his death, before the death of Muslim ibn Aqil. And he makes his preparation to leave and he announces that I am going. Now Mecca is a bit safer. The Umayyads don't have that much control over Mecca, so he can make some announcements. The people are more free to do as they please. He makes an announcement, he is going to Kufa. In Mecca, every single one of the senior Sahaba that was alive advised him against it. And we have so many narrations, even in books of hadith, not just books of history. In books of hadith, we have narrations that Abdullah ibn Abbas especially, and Abdullah ibn Abbas is also Ahlul Bayt, right? Abbas is the uncle of the Prophet. Abdullah ibn Abbas is the cousin of Ali, his father's cousin. Abdullah ibn Abbas is way senior to Hussein in terms of age and wisdom and participation in the Ghazawat. Abdullah ibn Umar, Jabir ibn Abdullah, comes to Mecca and warns him. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, every one of the Sahaba that was in the Hijaz, and they heard that he's preparing to basically, because this is a preparation that is now, is going to be war. You're going to Kufa, you're going to have the people of Kufa behind you, and the Umayyads on the other side, this is going to be war. All of the Sahaba were opposed to this. They've been through enough. And they feel that Hussein is being a little bit rash. That he was young when Siffin and Jamal took place. He's not old enough to realize the dangers or whatnot. Hussein, calm down. Hussein, this is not the way to go forward. You're going to cause destruction. You're not going to bring about any good. But Hussein was insistent and he showed them the letters of the people of Iraq. And he said, look at all of these letters. And he had two bags full. Now, what are bags? These are the massive bags you put on the camels. These are like huge, you know, leather cases that the camel has one bag on one side, the other bag on the other. He said, look. All of these letters have come from Kufa. Surely I have support. And Jabir said to him, do you not know how they betrayed your own father? Don't you remember the problems your own father had with the people of Kufa? But he said, no, they wouldn't do this now. This is now, clearly they're going to support me. So he left with his family on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, one day before Muslim ibn Aqil is thrown from the top, right? On the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, he leaves Mecca. And he takes with him his younger brothers. Now, Ali had married after Fatima, and Ali had children that were younger than Hussein. The most famous of these was Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah is a brother of Hassan and Hussein, but not through Fatima, right? That's why he's called Ibn al-Hanafiyyah. His mother was from the tribe of the Banu Hanifa. And there were other brothers as well that were even younger than Muhammad. And Muhammad is the most famous of them and the oldest of them after Hussein. And he also takes with him his nephews from the other brothers, his nephews from Hassan, Hassan's children. He takes some of Hassan's children. And he takes as well some of Ibn Aqil's children. These are all young men now, right? Muslim ibn Aqil has just died. They don't know this. He takes Ibn Aqil's children. And he takes Abdullah ibn Ja'far's children. Ja'far, remember Ja'far? The cousin who died. When did he die? We just did it in the seerah. When did he die? Oh, we didn't do it in the seerah. Sorry. Battle of Mu'tah. We're going to do that soon. That's why. The Battle of Mu'tah, he died, right? Ja'far passed away. These are the sons of Ja'far and the grandsons of Ja'far. So the Ahlul Bayt come forth. The total entourage when they left Mecca was over 100 people. Over 100 people, including women and children. Now, the books of history, Ibn Sa'd ibn al-Sabaqat, he mentions that Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah, his younger brother, went with him walking outside the city, persuading or trying to persuade him to the very last minute that don't go. Don't go, this is not going to bode well for you. And he said, and is also mentioned that Abdullah ibn Abbas, who was in Medina at the time, when he found out that Hussein is going to Kufa, he actually intercepted the caravan outside of Medina, basically, you know, finding where it is. And he went from Medina and he intercepted the caravan, one of the senior most Sahaba. And he is also Ahlul Bayt. Abdullah ibn Abbas is also Ahlul Bayt. And the both of them, Muhammad ibn Hanafiyyah and Abdullah ibn Abbas, are very senior in the Ahlul Bayt, and they're convincing Hussein not to go. This is going to be bloodshed. And Hussein answers the both of them with a phrase that clearly shows what he has in mind and what his intention was, and that is, I would rather die elsewhere than to open up the door for the haram to become an area of bloodshed. Meaning what? If he remains in Mecca, they'll come to Mecca. And so out of respect for Mecca, I don't want a civil war to take place in Mecca. I would rather die anywhere in the world than open up the haram to become bloody, right? And so out of respect for Mecca, but he has his mind that he wants to try to get to the power, but he doesn't want to open it up in the haram. So he goes, even if I die, that's fine. I'm not going to die in Mecca and cause bloodshed in Mecca. And as we said, Ibn Abbas, even Ibn Umar, others of the Sahaba, in fact, Ibn Umar, who was, as we said, the senior most companion alive. Abdullah Ibn Umar is the most respected Sahabi alive during this incident. Ibn Umar tracks him down on the way. And Ibn Umar says to him something very profound. And this is mentioned in our books of hadith, Ibn Hibban and others. This is in a hadith book. It's not even in the books of Sirah. It's also there, but it's also in hadith books. Ibn Umar says to him, the very final thing, when he's given up all hope, he says, okay, khalas, let me tell you a hadith I heard from the Prophet ﷺ, and I've never told anybody this hadith before. You're the first person I am telling. Now, this hadith is known to all of us, but when he said it, it wasn't known to him, right? Now we all know this hadith. What is this hadith? He said, when the Prophet ﷺ was on his deathbed, Jibreel came to visit him. And Jibreel gave him the choice. If you want this dunya, you shall have it. And if you want the akhirah, you shall have it too. We know this hadith that right at the end of the life of the Prophet, Jibreel allowed him. Do you want to live longer and get the dunya? Or do you want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Right? We know this hadith, right? And of course, what did the Prophet ﷺ choose? To meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He doesn't want this dunya. Then what did Ibn Umar derive from this? Ibn Umar said, and you are a part of the Prophet ﷺ. Bid'ah. You are the grandson. Right? So when the Prophet ﷺ chose the akhirah, he chose for you, basically. Right? And so you will not get any share of power. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, I don't want the dunya, I want the akhirah. And you, Ya Hussein, are a part of him. So when he chose the Akhirah, you guys are not meant to be kings. That's what he's telling him, right? You are not meant to be kings. Now, he didn't say the word king, but he said, but you shall not share any matter of that, meaning of power, and Allah has only turned it away from you to give you something better instead. Meaning, it is for your own benefit that you are not kings. And wallahi, this is so true, brothers and sisters. We believe this, that when you are a king or a ruler, politics always makes people unpopular. Politics, nobody likes politicians. This is a general rule, right? Politics brings about sab and shatam and ta'an and this and that. And the Ahlul Bayt should be preserved from that. The Ahlul Bayt are above this. The Ahlul Bayt are righteous and pure. And so Ibn Umar is saying, you are not meant to become kings. You're meant to be righteous people. Allah has meant something higher for you. Don't go. And so he's trying to convince him to the very last. And then he said to him, and as for the people of Iraq, don't you remember the treachery they gave to your own father? Have you forgotten? Now, the treachery they gave to Ali is beyond the scope of this class. You should just realize that Ali always complained about the people of Iraq and the problems that he had with them. But he still refused to listen. So everybody has told him it's not a wise idea, including his own brother, Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah. And that is why Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah refused to allow any of his own sons to go. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah, none of his own sons went to help Hussein what happened at Karbala, because he thought this is not a wise decision, right? And the point here is very clear, brothers and sisters, and that is, contrary to what the other group says, it's not a black and white issue. It's not a black and white. It's not that you're either on this side or on that side. We are on the side of Hussein in that we love him. But we say this decision wasn't in the best interest of Hussein or of the Ahlul Bayt or of the Ummah. We are not on the side of Yazid. If anybody, we're on the side of Ibn Abbas and Ibn Umar, right? That don't like Yazid. This is our position, as I'll come to the end. Yazid, astaghfirullah, is not our hero. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. But Hussein, we love him. But we say his emotions got the better of him. And it would have been better for him and the Ahlul Bayt if he listened to the other Ahlul Bayt, the senior Ahlul Bayt, such as Ibn Abbas, or the senior Sahaba, such as Ibn Umar. Nobody can accuse Ibn Abbas of being pro-Yazid. Nobody can accuse Ibn Umar of being pro-Yazid. But they were also anti-Khuruj of Hussein. They weren't anti-Hussein. They were saying this isn't the best decision. Nonetheless, he refused and he persisted to go forward. And when he comes close to Iraq, he sends a messenger to the people of Kufa that basically, guys, I'm coming, right? Be ready, I am coming. Now, Ibn Ziyad is now back in Kufa. He is waiting for Hussein to come. And anybody who's entering the city is being monitored extra now, right? Now, Hussein has no idea that Ibn Ziyad is in charge even. He still thinks the old governor is in charge. Hussein has no idea that Ibn Aqil has been killed. Hussein has no idea the plot has been exposed. He's in the middle of the desert. He's going there. Who's going to send him a message? As of yet, nothing happens. So he sends a messenger. The messenger is caught by the forces of Ibn Ziyad and executed. Now the messenger doesn't return. He sends a second messenger. Again, because Ibn Ziyad is on the prowl. Once again, this messenger is caught and is executed. But this second messenger, he actually manages to get the message to the people that Hussein is just coming. You had better prepare yourselves. And how does he do this? As a brave man, that he too was taken to the height of the tower to be thrown away. But the last thing that he said, he shouted out to the people that, O people of Kufa, Hussein is on his way. He's just about to come. Prepare yourselves. So he's still hoping that they might do something, right? So on his way down, basically, he warns them that Hussein is on his way and prepare yourself. Now, eventually, Hussein is very close to Kufa, and it is here that finally Ibn al-Ash'ath's messenger reaches him. Who's Ibn al-Ash'ath? The lieutenant who captured Ibn Aqil, right? He was faithful to this one request. Even though he killed him, he was still faithful. He made him promise that you must send Hussein. So finally, the message reaches Hussein. And the whole episode is now in front of his eyes. Ibn Aqil has been killed. Your followers have, the main leaders have been crucified in the compound, in the middle of the city. And none of the Kufans has supported Ibn Aqil. And you have been betrayed. And the message from Ibn Aqil, flee and go back to Mecca. Do not step foot in Kufa. And he is persuaded now to abandon. Very close to being now. Khala, there's nobody in Kufa to do it. But now the dialogue begins in his own camp. And remember, Muslim ibn Aqil's own sons are a part of the group. Now their father has just been killed. and they want revenge. And they say, we are not going to go back. We are going to avenge the death of our father. And while this is going on, another person in the party remarks that, oh Hussein, you are not like Ibn Aqil. When the people of Kufa see you, there's no way they would abandon you. You are the Sibt al-Nabi, you are Ibn Rasulullah, Ibn Rasul meaning metaphorically grandson. You are. And so the anger of the death of Muslim ibn Aqil and the encouragement of this other crowd. And wallahi, it makes sense. I mean, really, if you think about it from his perspective. Now, what is really key here for us as Sunni Muslims, in contrast to the Shia, their interpretation, we do not believe that Hussein marched to a suicide. We believe Hussein really thought he would win. You see the difference here, right? From the Shia perspective, they say Hussein knew he was marching to his death. But we say no. Hussein genuinely believed that when he got to Kufa, the people would support him. And the people would then fight him against the Umayyads. And he's still hoping, because remember, Kufa is one of the largest cities of the Muslim world at the time. Right? We said around 30,000-40,000 people have, you know, proverbially basically supported the uprising of Hussein. So he decides to march forward, and that was of course the mistake he made. He decides to march forward and Bismillah, let's see if we can get to Kufa. Now, meanwhile, when the people of Kufa hear that Hussein is coming, Ibn Ziyad requests backing and reinforcement. And Ibn Ziyad gets a large amount of troops that were sent to fight one of the Turkish provinces called the province of Daylam, the Daylamites, that they were going to wage ghazu against the Daylamites, 4,000 men. And Ibn Ziyad intercepted them and he got permission from Yazid that I need them against Hussein, right? So these people were not sent from Damascus to fight Hussein. They were sent to fight the Daylamites, the Turkic group up east and northeast, right? They were sent to fight a Turkish group northeast. And he got permission, northwest. It is northwest from Kufa. Northeast or northwest? I don't remember whether it's northwest. Yes, northwest, you're right, northwest, yes. Daylam is northwest, you're right. So the point being, northwest, northeast, they weren't sent to fight Hussein. Their niyyah was to fight the Daylamites. And he got permission to intercept this large group of troops and use them to basically threaten Hussein. So Hussein basically makes his way to Kufa, and it is in the plains of Karbala where these 4,000 men intercept Hussein, right? These 4,000 men intercept Hussein. Now, Karbala is literally, metaphorically, a stone's throw away from Kufa. It is very close to Kufa. These days you can drive between Karbala and Kufa, a short drive. It's not something that is a far away distance. So Hussein makes his way basically to a stone's throw outside of Kufa. And on the 3rd of Muharram in the year 61 Hijrah, this is when the forces of Ibn Ziyad intercept the small entourage of Hussein. And we had said that there were 100 people, and along the way more and more people joined because they're excited. When the messenger of Ibn al-Ash'ath came and said to him, flee and run and go back, Hussein made an announcement that, look, whoever wants to leave can leave because we have got the message that the situation is precarious. So guess what? Everybody left once again except for the Ahlul Bayt, the blood relatives. Once again, everybody basically left, and so they moved down once again to probably around 70 or 80 people at this point in time. And the leader of the army that was sent to Daylam, the leader of the army was Umar ibn Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. So Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, the famous Sahabi, right? His son is Umar. Now Umar is not a Sahabi, so whatever he didn't do, it has nothing to do with the Sahaba. His father died a long time ago, and this has nothing to do with his father. His father and him are basically two separate people. This is Umar, the son of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. And Umar is the military commander, so we need to now keep the hierarchy here. The governor is Ibn Ziyad. The military commander, Umar ibn Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Umar ibn Sa'd. And from the books of history, at least from our version of events, Umar ibn Sa'd, he was reluctant to basically trap Hussein and continue doing what was ordered to be done, but he also didn't stand up and say no. And so this makes him really guilty in his own way, but he wasn't the one encouraging. He basically was, as they say, the loyal soldier, that he tried his best, but he, in the end, did what he was told, and what he was told to do was obviously very wrong to do. Nonetheless, Umar ibn Sa'd intercepts the entourage of Hussein, and this takes place on what day? 3rd of Muharram, 61 AH, right? Now, contrary to the other reports of the Abu Mikhnaf and other reports that the siege lasted for 40 days and Ali was starving and thirst and whatnot, these are, you know, exaggerations that really are very, you know, they're very painful when you hear them, but there's no authenticity to them. The actual siege lasted 5 days. 6 days max, right? The actual siege was not drawn out for weeks and weeks. It's not even possible if you calculate it out. It's not even possible to have a siege that long, knowing that Ali left Medina, Hussein left Medina at this time, he would have reached Karbala at that time. It's not even possible for a siege to last for 40, 50 days at this point in time. The siege, it's not even a siege, it's basically they're stopped and they're surrounded. Call it a siege in its own way, but they're stopped and surrounded on the 3rd of Muharram. Umar ibn Sa'd sends a messenger to Hussein. Why have you come? Why have you left Mecca? And Hussein says, I have come at the invitation of the people of Kufa. And here are their messages. And he has those two big bags of hundreds of messages. Here are their messages that I didn't come of my own accord. They don't want the Umayyads. They have asked me to be their leader. And I have come to be their leader. Honest. There's no, this is Hussein. He's not going to astaghfirullah lie or be a coward. He told them the truth. They don't want you. They told me to be their leader, and I'm here to be their leader. And he said to Umar that, and he sees the situation is tense, he says that, look, if they no longer want me, if they have abandoned me as I have heard, then I will abandon them and I will go back as well. Let me go back now. Now that you surrounded me, I don't have an army to fight you. Let me go back. So Umar ibn Sa'd sent a messenger to Ibn Ziyad. Now again, this message is going to take a few, half a day, less than half a day. Go back to the city, come back here. And Ibn Ziyad sends the message back that tell Hussein, he must come to me in the palace and give me the oath of allegiance on behalf of Yazid. So Ibn Ziyad is arrogant, beyond reason. Now, very clear point here. This took place probably on the 3rd of Muharram itself, maybe even the 4th of Muharram, right? It is impossible that a message would have come from Kufa to Damascus and Yazid, and then Yazid sends a message back about what to do. What we believe is that the main culprit of this entire episode is Ibn Ziyad. This is the main culprit, that Ibn Ziyad acted impulsively, and we'll talk about Yazid in a while, and he insisted, you must bring Hussein to me. Now what arrogance, who are you? You 28-year-old kid, you're going to ask the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ to come humbly to you after he has said no to Muawiyah directly and Yazid directly. Now he's going to come and kiss your hand? Wallahi, this is arrogance. And we would not expect Hussein to do this. He said, no, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to go to Ibn Ziyad and kiss his hand and give the bay'ah to him on behalf of Yazid. Right? So when the message came from Ibn Ziyad, he must come to me. Hussein then says to Sa'd, Umar ibn Sa'd, look, go back and tell him one of three options. I give you three options, choose whichever you want. Number one, let me go back to Mecca. Khalas, okay. I wasn't able to get the people of Kufa. Let me go back the way I was. Okay. Number two, if you refuse to do this, then take me to Yazid directly and I will speak to him directly. Now, this is actually a sign of bravery. And it's also a sign, by the way, and this is very key here, that Hussein felt more comfortable negotiating directly with Yazid than with this impetuous governor Ibn Ziyad. Because Hussein and Yazid have a history. They've known each other, not friends, right? But Hussein and Yazid have negotiated together. Hussein knows Yazid's stance. Yazid knows Hussein's stance. And Muawiyah, his father had been very careful about making Hassan and Hussein irritated. That he was very respectful, he gave them stipend, whatever he could do to just basically give them some respect. And he told Yazid that be careful of Hussein and show him the utmost respect, make sure he never flips against you. So Yazid, Hussein actually said, let me go to him directly and I'll negotiate something. And if he had gone, we don't expect him to have compromised. He would have been firm, but it is our estimation that Yazid would never have killed Hussein directly. This is our estimation, right? And the books of history tend to prove this, as we will see. This is the second option. Then there's the third option. If you refuse this or that, then send me into exile into one of the faraway lands. If you're not going to let me live in Mecca or take me to Yazid, then khalas, let me be. Okay, you have won and I will just worship Allah in some faraway land, right? Now, these three conditions were so reasonable that one of the close friends of Umar ibn Sa'd said, wallahi, if the Turks and the Daylamites gave you one of these three conditions, you would be forced to accept them. How reasonable. What more do you want? And Umar ibn Sa'd became happy that, okay, now we're going to solve this. And he went personally to Ibn Ziyad and he said, okay, choose one of these three. Which one? Ibn Ziyad refused all three. And Ibn Ziyad said, either war or my hand. These are the two options you have. You either come and you put your hand in mine and you give the bay'ah on behalf of Yazid, or else there is no other alternative. And Ibn Ziyad sent one of his close entourage, and this really was the ruthless warrior, Shimr. Shimr is his name, that he sent. Shimr ibn Dhiljawshan was his name. Shimr ibn Dhiljawshan, and this really, the way that history portrays him, and wallahi, every right to do so, as being the barbaric, cruel warrior that he was, bloodthirsty, and we have no reason to doubt this. This is the way he was. That he sends Shimr to basically become the shadow of Umar ibn Sa'd, because Umar ibn Sa'd seems to have a soft spot. Right, so he sends Shimr to basically monitor Umar ibn Sa'd. And he sends Shimr that these are the two conditions he had, two options. You either come to me humbly and put your hand in mine, or else there is war. And by the time Shimr comes, this is the 9th of Muharram. The 9th, so for 6 days, five and a half days, back and forth, finally on the 9th of Muharram, Shimr comes and says, you either come to Ibn Ziyad, or else tomorrow there will be war, right? And there was a lot of tension. And many of the people on the side of Umar ibn Sa'd either abandoned the army of Yazid or the army of Ibn Ziyad, and a small group of them actually defected over to the side of Hussein. A small group of them. We didn't come to fight the grandson of the Prophet. Now you're going to... A small group of them came over to the side of Hussein, right? Now, the people of Kufa know full well what's going on. It's happening under their nose, literally under their nose. 6 days go by and not a single one of them comes forth to help the very person whom they have promised. It's literally happening there. And nobody comes to help Hussein ibn Ali. And so, of course, Hussein refused to go to Ibn Ziyad, and wallahi, this is exactly what we expect. Wallahi, this is exactly what we expect. Hussein was not a coward. Hussein is not. When he was at a time of peace and security, at a time of izzah, he refused to give bay'ah to Yazid. Now you expect him to give bay'ah when his life is threatened? La hawla quwwata billah. No way. This is the grandson of the Prophet. If you're going to kill him, you're going to kill him with dignity and karama. And there's no doubt that he chose the braver of the two options. Now that he's trapped, his back is to a wall, he's not going to go begging for his life in the hand of this young, impetuous governor. And so he refuses. And he says, be as it may, I am not going to go give bay'ah to Ibn Ziyad on behalf of Yazid. And so it came to pass on the morning of the 10th of Muharram of 61 Hijrah that a cruel and pitiless battle took place. On the one hand, you have barely 60, 70 men. And on the other hand, you have 3,000-4,000 people. On the one hand, you have the grandson of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and on the other hand, you have a bunch of rebels and army generals and whatnot. And so it came to pass that the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what his own grandfather said about him came true, because it is authentically narrated in our own Sunni books of hadith that Ali ibn Abi Talib once came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he saw him crying. And he said, "Ma yubkika ya Rasulullah, why are you crying, O Messenger of Allah?" Tears are coming out of his eyes. Why are your tears coming out of your eyes? So he said, and this hadith is in Muslim Imam Ahmad and in Tabarani, it is authentic. He said, "Jibreel just came to me and he told me that my own ummah shall kill Hussein next to the Euphrates River. And he brought me some of that sand where he will be killed. And this is what has made me cry." And the narrator of the hadith said that, and we knew that that sand, we later knew that the sand was the sand of Karbala. And so the army zoomed in on the camp, the entourage, and there was no warriors or fighters here. These are just a small group of men, most of whom are Ahlul Bayt. And Hussein in the beginning was protected by the Ahlul Bayt and they fought on his behalf, but one by one as they were killed, and Hussein is left standing. And in the very final act, Hussein kept on charging on. And who amongst them would dare come forth and raise a sword against the grandson of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And so everybody was just trying to avoid his own sword, Hussein's sword. Who's going to raise his hand? Until it was that infamous, that evil, that brute, it was Shimr ibn Abi Joshan that gave the commands to attack. And Shimr led a small group of 3 or 4 people, along with the person they say who actually dealt the actual final blow. His name is Sinan ibn Anas, somebody in the books of history, Sinan ibn Anas, who gave him the final death blow. And as a final act of brutality, Shimr and Sinan, they cut off the head of Hussein ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib and they sent it to Ibn Ziyad on a plate as a gift. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And Ibn Ziyad, when he got this plate with the head, and this is the first time in Islamic history such a barbaric jahili act was done. This is the first time ever this was done. And it shows you the mentality of the people who did this. And when Ibn Ziyad got this head on a plate, he took a stick and he began poking the head of Hussein and saying things, vulgar things. And Anas ibn Malik was there in Kufa at the time. He was an old man, Anas ibn Malik, the famous Sahabi. And he could not stand this. And he stood up in the gathering and he said, "Wallahi, I saw the Prophet ﷺ kiss those very lips that you are now hitting with this stick. La hawla la quwwata illa billah." And he said that nobody resembled the Prophet ﷺ more than Hussein. And wallahi, our hearts cry for Hussein. And wallahi, we are the Shia of Hussein, the real Shia of Hussein. And wallahi, I swear by Allah that if we had been there, we would hope to Allah that we would defend the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ against anybody who dares raise his hand against him. Wallahi, we are the true Shia of Hussein. And those who killed Hussein, they will have to answer to Allah for one of the worst murders committed. This child that the Prophet ﷺ played with, and he put him on his back, and he kissed him all over, and now his head is on a plate, and Ibn Ziyad is poking it. Anas ibn Malik could not stand this, and he said, "This very lips that you are making fun of, and you are poking, I saw the Prophet ﷺ kiss those very lips." And he said that Hussein resembled the Prophet ﷺ most in his manners. And there are some reports as well that Ibn Ziyad sent it to Yazid, but these reports seem to be a confusion. It was not Yazid who poked the face of Hussein, it was Ibn Ziyad. This seems to be the correct version of events. Yazid did not poke the face of Hussein, it was Ibn Ziyad. And in total, over 70 people were killed in the party of Hussein, 15 of them Ahlul Bayt, and all of the women and children were protected, none of them were harmed. The only male survivor was the son of Hussein, Ali, known as Zainul Abidin, Ali Zain al-Abidin. And the reason why he was saved from the massacre, he was sick with a very high fever and he was in the tent of the women and he was just tossing and turning in bed with that fever. And so when the massacre took place, he was actually in the tent of the women. So he was basically then spared. And so the progeny of Hussein to this day goes through Ali Zain al-Abidin, and then matters went on from there. Analysis and brief comments before we conclude. What are some of the effects of this massacre? Many effects. Most importantly, 4 years after the death of Hussein, 65 Hijrah, the people of Kufa, who call themselves Shi'atu Ali, this is the origin of the term, Shi'atu Ali, we are the party of Ali. they kept on feeling guilty, guilty, guilty for what they had done. And in the 65th year of the Hijrah, on the 10th of Muharram, a group emerged from amongst them who called themselves the Tawwabun, were sorry, the repenters. And they made it their duty to extract vengeance on those who had killed Hussein. And they said they're going to kill everybody who participated in the massacre of Hussein. And on their way to Syria to kill Ibn Ziyad, they passed by Karbala. And of course, the body of Hussein is most likely buried in Karbala. And they spent the whole night lamenting and crying and singing poetry and beating themselves. Why? For having failed to protect Hussein when Hussein needed their help. And with this incident, we can mark the beginnings of theological Shi'ism. Up until this point in time, Shi'ism is a political movement. Political. They don't say that the Ahlul Bayt are this and that. They don't say that Abu Bakr is. No, all of this is not there. It's just Umayyads versus Ahlul Bayt. And these are pro-Ahlul Bayt and anti-Umayyad. That's it. With this incident, slowly but surely, theology got added into it. And, you know, the issue of making the descendants of Ali into imams and into, you know, figures that we consider to be above and beyond what is our Sharia says, this began after the death of Hussein. With the death of Hussein is the birth of theological Shi'ism. That from this day on, a theology began to be, you know, devised. And then from there, of course, another turn took place. And this incident, believe it or not, was very similarly repeated. A deja vu took place in 122 AH from the son of Ali ibn al-Husayn, Zayn al-Abidin, and his name is Zayd. When Zayd, the son of Ali, the son of Husayn, the son of Ali, the son of Ibn al-Talib, see the lineage, right? Zayd was once again in Medina, and the people of Kufa promised him the same thing. His older relative said, don't go, don't go, don't go. And Zayd said, no, this time is going to be different. So in 122 AH, Zayd did the same journey from Medina to Kufa. And in Kufa, the people quizzed him, and they, most of them, rejected him. Why? Because they said to him, do you curse Abu Bakr and Umar? Why? Because in Kufa, theology is changing. In Kufa, they're making a theology out of it. And Abu Bakr and Umar become the worst people. So they said, do you curse Abu Bakr and Umar? And Zayd ibn Ali said, Waziray Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These were the wazirs of the Prophet. You want me to curse Abu Bakr and Umar? No, not possible. I am simply against the Umayyads, basically, right? And this shows us the real clash between theological Shi'ism and political Shi'ism. The Ahlul Bayt were Shi'a politically, not theologically. And the Shi'a of Kufa became Shi'a, what we call Shi'a. The irony of ironies, when Zayd came, they rejected their own imam as being too Sunni, basically. They rejected their own imam, that you don't curse Abu Bakr and Umar, how can we fight behind you? So they did not fight behind him, and the Umayyads came, sorry, the Abbasids at this time, not the Umayyads, the Abbasids came, and the Abbasids massacred Zayd, and this was the beginning of what we call Zaydi Shi'ism. Zaydi Shi'ism is a different branch of Shi'ism. It is still strong and powerful in Yemen. The only country in the world where you have Zaydi Shi'a is Yemen. And you have the Ithna Ashari Shi'a, which is the Shi'a of Pakistan and Bahrain and Iran and Iraq. This is Twelver Shi'ism. You compare the doctrines of Zaydi Shi'ism with Twelver Shi'ism, and you see the reality between political Shi'ism and theological Shi'ism. Zaydi Shi'ism respect Abu Bakr and Umar. Zaydi Shi'ism does not curse the Sahaba. Zaydi Shi'ism don't consider the Imam to be infallible and there's one Imam and Allah. All of this is not there in Zaydi Shi'ism, right? Zaydi Shi'ism is the real Shi'ism of the Ahlul Bayt. There's no theology that the Twelver Shi'ism went a whole different way. And that's the story beyond the scope of this. The final point, and it will take 5-10 minutes, the final point. Who is to blame? Who is to blame for the massacre of Hussein? The Sahaba that were alive at the time, they knew exactly who to blame. The companions squarely placed the blame on the people of Kufa. The number one culprits were the very people who claimed to be the partisans of Ali. And it is authentically narrated in the books of hadith, not even the books of history. Muslim, Imam Ahmad, Tirmidhi, we have these in the books of hadith. That when Umm Salama, who is Umm Salama? The wife of the Prophet ﷺ. When she heard of the death of Hussein and the martyrdom of Hussein, she said, may Allah's la'na be upon the people of Iraq. They were the ones who murdered him. قَتَلُوهُ قَاتَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ. They killed him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse them. They seduced him. They promised him. And then they abandoned him right at the very end. And we have the even more famous narration of the senior most sahabi, who is Abdullah ibn Umar, the most respected of the sahaba alive. He's not pro-Yazid. He doesn't like the Umayyads. He doesn't like the politics going on. And the famous, this hadith is in Bukhari. This hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. What is it? When a group of Hujjaj came to Mecca, right? And Ibn Umar was there. And they said, oh, this is Umar, let's ask him a question. So one of them comes and he says, oh, Ibn Umar, if I swat a mosquito and the blood comes, is my ihram broken? Now, remember in ihram, you're not supposed to hunt, right? So, and of course, I mean, Sunni fiqh, I don't know any fiqh. Mosquitoes are not hunting. You don't hunt mosquitoes, right? So you can swat a fly and mosquito. So if I swat a mosquito, do I have to pay dam fidya for this blood? And he was shocked. He goes, where are you from? He said, from Kufa, from Iraq. He said, wa ajaban. Amazing are you people. Amazing are you people. You kill the grandson of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You murder him. And now you come and ask me about the blood of a mosquito? Now who is he blaming? The people of Kufa. And wallahi, this is crystal clear. And we have to say this no matter how painful or awkward it is. This is the truth. And that is why this group beats themselves to this day. This is the truth that nobody can deny. And the Sahaba that were alive, none of them is pro-Yazid. Wallahi, it's impossible for a believer to be pro-Yazid. But being anti-Yazid doesn't necessarily mean we agree with everything that happened there. No, not at all. We say that the people who promised Hussein should have been the ones that lived up to the promise. Where were they when Ibn Aqil is thrown? Where were they when Hussein is camped outside their city for 6 solid days? Where were they? Instead of cursing everybody else in the world, even those who were born before Hussein, wallahi, they need to look at their own selves. Wallahi, this is the truth. They need to look at what they themselves have done. And their betrayal, and their cowardice, and the fact that they were bribed so easily from what they promised him. So, the number one culprit, according to our own sources and their own sources, that's why they beat themselves on that day, and they continue to do so. The number one culprits are those who seduced, those who promised, those who swore the most solemn oaths, and then they disappeared. Bayna ashiyat and wuduhaha, between the morning and an afternoon, they all disappeared from Ibn Aqil, and not one of them showed up when Hussein is camped outside. These are the people, instead of cursing those who were born before Hussein, wallahi, they need to look at themselves and what they have done. That's number one. Okay, they're cowards. They're traitors who betrayed Hussein. Okay, but they didn't pull the trigger, as we say. They didn't fight with the sword. So, who then is the one who is guilty of the blood? They're guilty of cowardice and betrayal. And wallahi, that's the biggest guilt. Because if they had stood up, Karbala would not have happened. If the people of Kufa had stood up, they would have protected Hussein. They would have had to negotiate. Something would have done. So that's the number one culprit. Number two, who is the mastermind? Clearly the mastermind is Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. Ibn Ziyad is the main culprit. The governor, this impetuous, arrogant young man that was placed to be the governor. And Ibn Ziyad, we give him the lion's share of the blame. And there is no doubt. It is clear even in his own lifetime that Allah punished him. His whole lifetime was just uprisings and intrigue and backstabbings until he died a miserable death. The forces of Mukhtar al-Thaqafi, another internal uprising, he was killed by the forces of Mukhtar. And notice the irony of ironies, and this is sunnat Allahi fi khalqihi. His own head was decapitated. And his head was brought in front of the people of Mukhtar on a plate. And it was shown just like the head of Hussein was shown to him. And this is in Sunan al-Tirmidhi. This is in Tirmidhi, not even the books of history. And they say when the head was brought in front of the majlis, everybody was terrified. Why? Because out of nowhere, a snake came into this grand audience and made its way straight into the head and went into the nose and resided in the skull of Ibn Ziyad. This isn't Tirmidhi. It's not even in the books of history. Sunan al-Tirmidhi mentions that the head of Ibn Ziyad was punished in this way in front of the people to see. So this is Ibn Ziyad. Ibn Ziyad is the brains, but he didn't actually come to the battle. Ibn Ziyad is the brains and he has the lion's share. And if he wasn't so stubborn, then might have taken another turn. Who gets the lion's share of the physical blame? No doubt the leader of the army, Umar ibn Sa'd, we accuse him of being a coward to Ibn Ziyad. From the books, it seems he was very reluctant. He tried his best to get out, but when push came to shove, he didn't get in the way. And when Umar ibn Sa'd was a little bit too cowardice, as we said, Ibn Ziyad sent Shimr. So Umar ibn Sa'd, we don't say he's innocent. He could have done something, but whatever got in the way, and he didn't really get between them, so there is some share on him. But when it comes to the actual sword and the blood on the sword, there is no doubt that it is Shimr ibn Dhiljawshan, Shimr, and then they say Anas ibn Sinan is one of his thugs as well that was with him. These were the two people that really, and along with three, four other people there, I mentioned some of them by name, but it was Shimr who charged for it, the first person to raise his sword and go towards Ibn Rasulullah. Everybody else was respectful. Everybody else, who's going to raise the sword against Hussein, right? It was Shimr who did that and charged, and when he charged, his three, four thugs basically charged with him, and him along with Anas and the two, three, they're the ones who killed him. So, all of these are guilty. Okay, we went down. We need to now go up. And with this we conclude. We need to go up. We went down. Ubaydah ibn Ziyad and Umar. And how about up? Who's the one? Where does the buck stop? Yazid. Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan. What is our position about Yazid ibn Abi Sufyan? There's a whole spectrum of opinion. Yazid ibn Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. There's a whole spectrum of opinion within Sunni Islam. And there's not one unanimous consensus within Sunni Islam. You have those within Sunni Islam who curse him by name and call him a kafir. And they say he is the worst person to ever have existed. And let us also be honest here, and it really saddens me to say this, but we also have the opposite extreme. We have those to this day, they make every excuse for Yazid. And they make him out to be a righteous man who circumstances were beyond his control. And they try to exonerate him from every single crime that he is accused of. And wallahi, this is bordering on the fitna called Nasibism. This is beyond the scope of this class, but this is ridiculous. You're going to say Yazid was innocent? The buck stops there. Yazid was in charge. Yazid was the boss. Yazid sent Ibn Ziyad. We cannot overlook this fact. Now, therefore, in my humble opinion, and this is the position of Ibn Hajar and al-Dhahabi and Ibn Kathir and Ibn Taymiyyah, this is the standard moderate Sunni position. This is what I believe as well. I believe, it's up to you to take your own position, and I'm following here Ibn Hajar and the majority of scholars, that Yazid takes a share of the blame, but he did not intend for Hussein to be killed. He sent the ruthless guy to be ruthless with anything less than actual murder. He didn't tell Ibn Ziyad to kill Hussein. But here's the flip side now. We're not exonerating him. When the death of Hussein came to him, he did not punish a single person for that. And had he really been that sorry and that angry, he would have made an example of Ibn Ziyad and Shimr and Sina. He would have done something. But he didn't lift a finger. And the fact of the matter, therefore, is that there is no doubt that Yazid takes a good share of the blame. And this is really what the majority of Sunni scholars said as well, that it is narrated in our books that when the news of Hussein's death reached Yazid, he said, "I did not command you to kill him. I would have been content with the allegiance of Kufa and you could have left Hussein alone. You didn't have to force him into this, you know, either this or that. As long as the Kufan people were not with him, that's all that I wanted, basically, right?" And historically, this makes sense. Hussein was surrounded by Ibn Ziyad on the 3rd of Muharram, and he was killed on the 10th of Muharram, 7 days. It is impossible to get a message to Yazid and back from Kufa to Damascus. What is to be done? Impossible. There is no way Yazid could have known the details. There's no way Yazid could have had an input in what happened. But when he found out what happened, neither did he do anything. Ibn Taymiyyah says, Yazid did not order the killing of Hussein, nor did he show happiness on this. Even though he showed sadness, still he did not support Hussein, nor did he exact any revenge or punishments on those who killed Hussein. And this is historically true. That he said shouldn't have happened, I'm sorry. He said it, I'm sorry. He expressed regret. But of what use is expression when the guilty culprits go away? And therefore, Imam Ahmad was asked about Yazid. His son asked him, Abdullah. His son said, Oh Abati, oh my dear father, are we supposed to love Yazid? Is it a part of our theology to love Yazid? Listen to Imam Ahmad's response. And does anybody with Iman love Yazid? This is Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Does anybody with Iman love Yazid? So then his son flipped the question. He said, so should we curse him? So Imam Ahmad said, have you ever heard your father curse anybody by name? And so the message was clear. We don't love Yazid. But another person asked him, should we curse Yazid? And he said, it is not sunnah to curse people by name. We curse generically. We should say, ala la'natullahi ala al-zalimin. So he said, he didn't defend Yazid. He said, curse generically. Ala la'natullahi ala al-zalimin. And leave it at that. And it is not of our methodology to curse people by name. Yazid, the fact of the matter, was a king, a politician, like other politicians. And the blood on his hand is no more or great in terms of quantity. In fact, it is less than the blood of many later kings. But what's the difference? The quality of blood. The fact of the matter is that these uprisings are a common motif of Umayyad and Abbasid times. And people after Yazid killed more than Yazid. But the people that Yazid killed are not your average people. They were the grandson of the Prophet ﷺ. Ibn Taymiyyah says, we are just in this regard. We don't curse him. And he was like the other kings. He had good and he had bad. And in our religion, Allah will accept the good and his affair with his Allah. He might be punished for the bad. We leave his affair to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we do not curse him by name. We may say, ala la'natullahi ala al-zalimin. And we leave it at that. And a final point is that, no doubt we love Hussein. And we are saddened by his death. But our love for Hassan is greater than our love for Hussein. And the ahadith about Hassan are more than the ahadith about Hussein. And it is authentically narrated in Bukhari that once the Prophet was giving a khutbah and Hassan walked in and he tripped and he fell down. And the Prophet stopped the khutbah and came down and picked Hassan up, Hassan. And he kissed him on the mimbar. And he said that, I could not bear to see my son fall down. And then he said, "Inna bni hadha sayyid." This son of mine shall be a true leader. Even if Muawiyah doesn't consider him a leader, the world considers him a leader. He is the Sayyid over and above Muawiyah. This is something we have no doubt about. This son of mine is the Sayyid. And perhaps Allah will bring reconciliation between two large groups of Muslims through him. Hassan was the better of the two men. Hassan was the one who stood up and said, no more bloodshed. You want the power? Take it. I'll retire. I don't want Muslims to be killed. This was maturity. This was Iman and wisdom. And Hussein had Iman, but the wisdom of Hassan was more than Hussein. And this is what we believe, that Hassan had the more wise methodology, and Hussein, no doubt, was a brave man, and he did what he did. And Allah Azza wa Jal will accept from him his martyrdom, inshaAllah ta'ala. To conclude, the tragedy of Karbala is a great tragedy. Our hearts bleed for the death of Hussein. But the tragedy of Karbala is a historical tragedy, not a theological one. The fact of the matter is that the murder and assassination of Uthman ibn Affan caused more harms to the Ummah and more doors of fitna were opened up than the murder and assassination of Hussein ibn Ali. And our love for the Ahlul Bayt does not cause us to go to the two extremes. We are between the two extremes. We love them for the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we are angry at all those who oppose them. And we say to those who abandon him at the very last hour, you are the primary culprits in the death of Hussein. Don't curse Abu Bakr, don't curse Umar, don't curse Uthman. You were the people who abandoned the very person whom you promised to help. You have the lion's lion's share of the blame, and therefore this is something that we clearly and firmly believe. And I conclude by saying that we are the true followers of Ahlul Bayt, we are the true lovers of Ahlul Bayt, we are the true Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib. We go between the two extremes, and we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala extols their ranks and causes them to enter Jannah and causes us to be along with them in Jannah. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. And with this, my dear brothers and sisters, the fact of the matter is, wallahi, I've gone way beyond what I need to. We need to break in 5 minutes, so I will just take two questions inshaAllah ta'ala, and then we need to break. I do apologize, but we are late and we also have to pray Asr. We are late for Asr. So just two questions. The first question we have, that what happened to the head of Hussein? What happened to the head of Hussein? So the head of Hussein, there's a whole treatise written by Ibn Taymiyyah called the treatise on the head of Hussein. And what appears to be the case, inshaAllah ta'ala, is that the head of Hussein was sent to Yazid wrapped in a silk cloth. He did not dishonor it, and he handed it to the family of Hussein, and the family of Hussein took it to Medina, and they buried it in Baqi' al-Gharqad next to the body of Hassan. So the body of Hassan and the head of Hussein, they are buried in Medina. This is what seems to be the strongest opinion, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And we also have a question over here, that is the salvation of a Muslim dependent upon acknowledging the martyrdom of Hussein? So we said before, the martyrdom of Hussein is a historical tragedy of the highest magnitude, but it is not a theological issue. It is a historical tragedy, and our heart bleeds historically for what happened. But our theology, our aqidah, our fiqh, our laws do not change by the death of Ali or Hussein or Uthman or any of those sahaba who passed away. Our aqidah does not change at that, and therefore their martyrdom will be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshaAllah, but it is not something that changes our beliefs and our theology. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. I do apologize that there's no time for more questions, but we really do have to conclude. And so with this, wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Yes, wa alaikum assalam. So I will be teaching a class in England for Ilm Summit in the month of December. It is an intensive class about the development of political and theological Shi'ism. And we'll talk about this from an academic manner, about what exactly happened and how these changes came about, and how did these ideas come about the Imam and being the Ma'soom and infallible, and the evolution of all of these ideas. We'll talk about it bit by bit and go into the history of the evolution of Shi'ism and go down every single branch, the Twelver Shi'ites, the Zaydis, the Fatimites, the Ismailis, the Aghakhanis, the Druze, every single group, the Nusaydis and Alawis, how do they differ? We'll talk about it historically and theologically, and inshallah we'll talk about it in an academic manner, not an emotional manner, as you even saw today. Inshallah, we are talking about this in an academic style, and our goal is not to incite hatred or you know, animosity. Our goal is to preach what we believe to be the truth. Wa jazakumullahu khairan. And with that, Ammar, I need to hang up over here because it's time for the salah. So wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.